Well, students, so far we have been through with number of the systems with respect to the human body, digestive, respiratory, circulatory, skeletal, endocrine, nervous. And then the second last system that we are left with is the muscular system. Although from an understanding point of view, the system is as small, but yet very important system. Because when we look at the muscular system as a system or in totality, what we realize is that all the sort of the movements, moving of the hands, moving of the legs, or even speaking, when I'm speaking, my jaw, my lower jaw is going up and down. All these movements, they are the consequence or the result of nothing but of the muscular movement. The muscles in my body, they are helping to impart or to give this movement. If these muscles will stop working, no movement. A person, a live person, would be just like a dead stone or a rock lying on the ground because there is no movement. So, the muscular system, like any other system, is an important system for a healthy, successful, happy life, right? So let's look into the system, that what actually it is. Now, in muscular system, we are talking about what? We are talking about the muscles. And what actually is a muscle? When I say muscle, just like, if someone asks me, what are you holding? I say pen. What is pen? A device that helps me to write. Same fashion if I say, it's a muscle. What actually is the muscle? When we look at this definition of muscle, we see that muscle is nothing but is a bundle of fibrous tissue of the body. Fibrous tissue means the word fibrous has come from the word fiber. Either you write it F-I-B-R-E or you write F-E-B-R. The spellings varies from book to book. It's just like a rope, a cotton thread, or a jute rope. If you take a rope, it's a bundle. Bundle of what? Fibers. If it is a cotton thread, then it's a bundle of cotton fibers. If it is jute, then it is a bundle of fibers of jute. As if you see, if you just unroll it, you can separate the fibers. In the same fashion, like that bundle, we see in the rope, we see the muscles. And what these fibers are, that these muscles are made up of, these are called myofibrils. Myofibrils. That means, myo plus fibrils. That is, fibers making the muscles are called myofibrils. And the function is, what the muscle is doing, actually it is doing what the myofibrils are doing. So, what the function of the muscle or myofibril is to provide movement to the body parts, to provide movement to the whole body. If you remember that many times, We have discussed the issue of the word of locomotion, movement and locomotion. Movement is like just moving this hand while I'm standing. This is movement. Now, if I start walking, I start running, swimming from one place to another place, then that becomes locomotion. Naturally, movement is a part of locomotion, but a movement cannot be a locomotion. A locomotion can be a movement, but a movement may or may not be considered as locomotion. Am I right? I repeat, a locomotion is a result or is a consequence of movement. Different body parts move together, coordinate together and give away or impart the locomotion. But if I say a given movement is a locomotion, I can't, because all movements cannot be considered as locomotion, as the whole body part may not move from one position to another. It may be a body part, not the whole body. Now, when we look at these muscles, then looking at the muscles based on their structure and the function. Muscles based on the structure and functions have been classified into three categories. Let's look at those categories. These are cardiac muscles. Cardiac means the muscles found in human heart. Skeletal muscles means found attached to skeleton. And when we talk of skeleton, we talk of bone. And smooth muscles, that means the body part which are neither the heart part nor the skeleton or bones, but the other tissue part, the soft body part of the body. Those are the smooth muscles. And these are also called as striated, striated and smooth. Why are they called so? We'll come back to it later, a bit later. But what here important for you to know is that cardiac muscle are the heart muscle. Why? Because they are found nowhere else in the body except in the middle wall of the heart. The middle wall of the heart, that is myocardium, is made up of muscles that we call as cardiac muscles. Skeletal muscles all over the body, the muscles that are attached to the bones, whether they are the bones in the hands, bones in the leg, bones in the neck region or in the jaw, wherever it is. If a muscle attached to the bone, then it is a skeletal muscle or a striated muscle. But if a muscle is neither found in heart nor is attached to the body bone, then this muscle is none but the smooth muscle. Like alimentary canal, there is no bone in my alimentary canal, entire system. In respiratory system, there is no bone. So the muscles that are found in the respiratory system, muscles that are found in the digestive system, muscles that are found inside the blood vessels, these are the muscles that are none but the smooth muscles. Let's look at them a bit more depth, because that understanding of the type of the muscle and the structure is important from the examination point of view. Now, looking at them, these are the three muscles that you saw. striated muscles, also called skeletal muscles. Why? Because they are found attached to the body skeleton. They are voluntary. Voluntary means they depend upon my will. Whether I want them to act or work or not. If I want, they will work. If I don't, they won't. With alternate light and dark band. Here comes the word striated and non-striated. That if I look at a muscle like this, I'll find it has got a band, which, if observed under the microscope, appear light followed by dark and dark followed by light. These light and dark bands are because of the proteins that the muscles are made up of. And there are only two type of proteins. Actually, there are four. But what you need to know is two. And these main ones are actin and myosin. All muscles, irrespective of their type, that is, whether it is a skeletal muscle, is a cardiac muscle, or a smooth muscle, it is made up of two main protein types. These are called actin and myosin. Because the movement of these mass, these proteins, are the ones that lead to the contraction and relaxation of the muscles. Contraction and relaxation of the muscle, that is the working of the muscle, is dependent upon the working of the two proteins that the muscles are made up of, called actin and myosin. Now, if a muscle fiber has got these alternate light and dark bands, I call it striated muscle. If it does not, then naturally it becomes non-striated. And non-striated means smooth. As it is stated, that non-striated are also called smooth muscles. These are involuntary. Involuntary means they are not in my control. They are not under my control. I have eaten the food, I have swallowed, and my part is over. Now is the body muscles that will do the rest of the work. If I want that my food that I have eaten should not go down into duodenum or into ileum, there is no way I can stop it. It will go. I have inhaled the air. My job is over. It's the body's job to have the inhaled air to reach to alveoli. There is no way I can stop that air from reaching into alveoli if I have inhaled it. Heart. My heart is beating. Can we stop our heart to beat? No way. Because these are the involuntary functions, they are beyond my control. Blinking of eyes, maybe for some time, I may forcefully don't blink. But there come a time, then I would fail to control the blinking. Blinking means closing and opening of the eyelids. Why? Because it's a sort of involuntary exercise. It's an exercise that my body performs for which I have no control. And hence, these non-striated muscles and cardiac muscles, they are involuntary muscles. The only difference between the striated muscles and the cardiac muscles is that striated muscles, the skeletal muscles, are the ones found attached to the bones. Whereas cardiac muscles are the ones that are found in the middle wall of the human heart or heart of any animal. It's not only the human. Even if I take a bird, a heart of a bird, and just look into the middle wall of the heart of a bird, the muscles there, as long as the heart is beating, would be having the cardiac muscles. So these are the three basic type of the muscles that are found in the body. Then, looking at this, if we look at this, that a skeletal muscle is like this. Alternate bands like this. This part is the dark band. Followed by light band. It's just like in sound, you might have heard of the word rarefaction and compression. Dark band represents the compression and the light band represents the rarefaction. And then, what we have is, we have the nucleus, which are not placed centrally. They are present on the sides, at the periphery. And the condition is multinucleated. That is, a single myofibril has got more than one nuclei. And the position of the nucleus is peripheral. That means on the sides. Now, this is what we have got, the skeletal muscles. And these are cylindrical. Straight. And unbranched. But if I compare the skeletal muscle to the cardiac muscles, which are also the striated muscles, we see number of differences. One is that these muscles are straight and cylindrical. In case of the cardiac muscles, they are straight but branched like this. That means they are cylindrical but branched. And then skeletal muscles are multinucleated. When we look at the cardiac muscles, they are not. They are uninucleated. And the last one is, in this case of skeletal muscles, the nucleus is peripheral, that is found on the side. In this case, the nucleus is found in the middle, is centrally placed. Centrally placed nucleus. So these at the last. Skeletal muscles are voluntary, whereas cardiac muscles are involuntary muscles. These are the basic differences between the skeletal muscles and the cardiac muscles. Because if I look at the smooth muscles are like spindle shape. pointed at the ants with the nucleus in the middle and these proteins here spread or scattered within the cytoplasm. That is what we call as sarcoplasm. Right? So that's the basic difference that underlies between the striated cardiac and the smooth muscles. Now let's look into the questions that have so far been asked with respect to the muscular systems in the last many years of the papers that have come up. First, which of the statement given below is correct about the bones and muscles contribution to total weight? That means if a person is 100 kg, let's say a person weighs 100 kgs or 100 newtons, not kg, 100 newton. How much of his body weight would be contributed by bone and would be contributed by muscles? Bones contribute to 15% and muscle to 45%. Bones contribute to 40% and muscle to 25%. Bones contribute to 35 and muscle to 20. Bones contribute to 20 and muscles to 35. Naturally, if you look at, you might feel that bones are heavier than muscles. No doubt they are. But when we look at the total weight of all the bones in the body, that is 206 bones that we have, and we weigh them and try to find the ratio with respect to more than 600 muscles that we have in our body, find the weight and the ratio, we find that A is the correct option. That bones, all the 206 bones in the body of an adult human, contributes only to the 15% of total body weight, whereas the muscles that are more than 600, there is no fixed number for the number of the muscles present in the body. It depends upon number of the factors. So all the bone, all the muscles that are present in the body, they contribute to the total of the 45% of the body weight. Right? Next. In human body, the smallest the body muscle is found in nose, ears, eyes, phalanges, and the fingers. You know the smallest bone in the body is stirrup. Or you also call it stapes. And it's an ear ossicle. Naturally, the smallest bone is going to be attached to the muscle, which is the smallest. So the correct option is ears. The smallest muscle of the body is the muscle found attached to the ear ossicle, the third ear ossicle, called stirrup or stapes. Next. Given below are the facts about gluteus maximus. Gluteus maximus, one of the main body muscle, largest body muscle, helps in chewing of food in mouth, only muscle not innervated by nerves, helps you to walk upstairs using ladders. That means while you are climbing from the ground floor to the first floor, from first floor to the second floor. Where does the gluteus maximus comes in? Is it the largest muscle of the body? Then helps in chewing of the food, that means it is present in the mouth. Only muscle non-innervated by nerve, there is no muscle that is not innervated by nerves. All muscles, irrespective of their type, are innervated by nerves. Helps you walk upstairs using ladder. Which is the correct? The correct is D. Gluteus maximus is one of the largest muscles of the body and is the one that helps you climb, because when you climb, you see your thigh muscles working more effectively than any other part of the body muscles or any other body muscle. So it is the one that helps you to climb or to run. And is also one of the largest of the muscles present in the body. I am using the word largest, not the strongest. There is a difference between something which is large and something which is strong. So be careful. One of the largest body muscle is gluteus maximus. While it is a muscle that helps us to walk, to run, or to climb upstairs. Next. The strongest body muscle, as I mentioned in the previous question, the largest and the strongest. Here we are talking of the strongest body muscle. Masseter is found in, where do we find masseter, the strongest body muscle? In the heart, thigh, lower jaw, upper arm. It is present in the lower jaw. The mandible, lower mandible we also call it. Because mandible is the scientific name, biological name for the jaw. Lower jaw, the lower mandible is the one which is connected to the strongest of the body muscle. That's why you see that when we are chewing the food, whether the food is soft or is hard, we still manage to chew it. Even sometimes using these teeth, we even crack the nuts, which have got thick walls. So, why? Because the muscles help us apply the force, and that force help us to chew or crack or to tear or bite, whatever you may say, or you may take it, because that's the basic function of the teeth, cutting, tearing, and chewing. So in all these things, these muscles, they help. Next, the hardest of the working muscle. Now, there was largest, strongest, and now the hardest of the working muscle. The word is working muscle, is in pinna. Does it keep on working? Tongue, does it keep on working every fraction of a second? Heart, yes. Heart keeps on working every fraction of a second. Diaphragm comes the second, because when we are breathing, inhaling and exhaling, that's when the diaphragm comes to play a role. And you know that the normal breathing is about 14 to 16 times per minute. While it comes to the heart, heart beats about 72 times per minute. Right? Therefore, that means the heart muscles are working more harder than the muscles of the diaphragm. And diaphragm in itself is a muscular sheet that is providing a base for the lungs to rest on. So, the correct option is C. Next. In body, the muscles are attached to bones. With tendon, motor nerve plate, ligament, synovial membrane. Naturally, at the joint, if there is a joint like this, Let's say these two bones are attached. Then there's another muscle. There's a muscle that's coming from the upper bone and is joining here. This is the second, this is the muscle. And this is the point of the joint. And this is again a point of joint. In this, it is B to B. That is bone to bone. Bone of one is joined to the bone of other part of the joint. In this case, muscle of one is attached to the muscle of the second, to the bone of the second. That is bone to muscle. What we realize is that, what we know is that, B to B is ligament, whereas B to M or M to B is tendon. Tendons are the connective tissues. These are connective tissues proper, which connect the muscles to the bone or bone to the muscles. Whereas ligaments are the connective tissue proper, these are fibrous tissues, which connect the bones of a joint, provided the joint is a synovial joint. Because synovial joint means movable joint. And these joint, this membrane, where the two bones meet like this. They are not attached. There is a space between the two bones at the joint. Now the membrane of this and membrane of this is what we call a synovial membrane. And the space between these two bones is filled with a fluid, with a liquid that we call a synovial fluid. That we call a synovial fluid. That's why in the skeletal system you have heard of osteoarthritis, that the old people starts complaining about the joint pains after an age. Why? Because this synovial membrane has rubbed off, it has degenerated. So the volume of the synovial fluid present in here has also reduced. Such that now bones rub each other, and that rubbing, physical rubbing of the bones, causes the joint pains. Next, which of the following does not involve any muscular action? That no muscle is involved. Blinking of eyes, you are moving your eyelids up and down, that is closing and opening your eyes. You are hearing a song, a good song that you like the most, you are hearing it. Feeling pain in the body, you are having a stomach ache or you are having a headache, whatever the case may be. Or chewing food. Now, in blinking of eyes and chewing of food, there is a movement. In hearing of song, again there is a movement. That is, my eardrum moves forward and backward. Feeling of pain is only nervous. It is only nervous. There is no muscle involved in the feelings. Because I am feeling a pain. No one is pinching me. There is no force or pressure being applied. So there is no muscular action. It's just a simple feeling. And hence, C is the correct option. Feeling of pain is an action. Thinking about something is an action that does not involve any muscular role. There is no muscle involved even if I am thinking of something. No, there is none. Next. The most of the heat generated in the body to maintain body temperature comes from. Our body temperature is 36.9 degrees Celsius, or you can say 37 degrees Celsius, or 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. You can put in either of the unit. Now, this temperature remains constant. And maintenance of this temperature is what we call as homeostasis. That is thermoregulation, maintenance of the body temperature. What contributes to this thermoregulation from the part of the muscle? Is it when muscles are contracting, or is it when the muscles are relaxing, or muscles are tired, fatigue means tired? Muscular spasm, they have been, that means they have been unduly stretched. That leads to the pain. Naturally, when we look at the muscle is working more when it is contracting. That's when it uses the maximum of the energy, and a part of that energy is lost or is given out or is irradiated. And that irradiated energy helps to maintain the body temperature. That's why you see, in the winter when it is cold, what you do, you rub your hands like this. What is happening? By rubbing your hands, or you start shivering. That means, now your muscle starts contracting and relaxing. And it is during the course of contraction, what happens? The heat is produced inside our body. More heat is produced. And that more heat produced in the body helps us feel warmer than before.